There are several ways in which you can categorize logos. I'm going to break them down into the following groups: wordmarks, symbols, combos, and taglines. Let's have a look at some examples of each. Some logos are nothing more than type, commonly referred to as a wordmark. The company name set in a specific font, possibly with some clever modification or subtle twist to the type. Some logos are symbols or brand marks, or at least there is a version of the logo that uses just a symbol without any supporting type. Most logos combine a specific use of type with a symbol. This is sometimes referred to as a logo lockup. It's common for a company to use all three variants: wordmark, symbol, and lockup. In addition to these three broad types of logo, another thing to consider is the tagline. There may be a variant of the logo that combines the type and symbol with a tagline, a short statement, slogan, or catchphrase that describes what the company does or suggests the positive aspects of consuming its product. Your use of type plays a big part in conveying the message of your brand. There are no definitive right or wrong choices, just ones that are more appropriate or less appropriate for your brand. Here are some general comments about how type can carry your message and the voice that different categories of type have. Starting with serif fonts. Serifs have a timeless look. They can make your logo look classic, serious, sophisticated. The serifs are outlined here in red. And here are some examples of fonts using serif typefaces. But there are different types of serifs. This is a slab serif. And slab serifs are more solid and can give a logo a sporty or vintage feel. A sans serif font, i.e. without the serifs, creates a clean, simple look which can be effective for modern brands. Script fonts suggest handwriting. They can be elegant and formal, or friendly and informal. If the lettering is custom hand lettering, it can convey individualism and craftsmanship. The Adobe Fonts website allows you to choose typefaces based upon their classification and characteristics. So, for example, if I were looking for a sans serif typeface that was suitable for headings with a medium weight and a medium width and a high X height and medium contrast, here is my short list of options. If you don't have a Creative Cloud subscription, there are many great free or shareware fonts available on sites like Google Fonts and DaFont. Make sure you test drive a variety of font styles to get a sense of how distinctly a typeface can represent your brand. Customizing your letters turns your type into a bespoke rather than an off-the-peg solution. For example, taking one of the letters and making it bigger than the rest, or taking away a part of a letter, or adjusting the letter shapes so that you accentuate the negative space between a given pair of letters. You can customize your type in this way using Adobe Illustrator. Select the editable type and then convert it to outlines, at which point you have a number of options. For example, if I wanted to extend the stem of the T, I could do that. For those letters that contain counters or interior shapes, I could delete them or color them. And I can also choose additional shapes. Here I'm using the polygon tool. I'm tapping my down arrow to reduce the number of sides. And I'll make a triangle. Now, if I were to position this triangle over the top of the U, for example, I can now come and select the U in combination with that, and using my Pathfinder tools, I can combine those two shapes together. Just before I do that, I'm going to duplicate that shape and put it over there so I can use it in a different way in just a moment. So I'll select those two shapes, combine them into a single shape. Or I might want to position a shape over a portion of the letter, select both, and subtract the topmost shape. So those are just some simple things that you can do to customize your letter shapes and really make them your own. One of the most important things to keep in mind when thinking of a shape to include in your logo is that it doesn't need to be complicated. The symbol in your logo doesn't need to be literal. The Apple logo doesn't show a computer. The Nike logo doesn't show a running shoe. Nor is a modern-day logo like a 19th century trademark. There's no requirement to include a specific visual reference to the trade you're working in. Many of the world's most famous logos are derived from universal visual elements. Squares and rectangles, which are solid and trustworthy. Circles and ovals that are infinite. Triangles, which are dynamic. Rotate a triangle and it becomes an arrow, indicating direction. Polygons and stars. Polygons, which have different meaning depending on the number of sides. Hexagons make a honeycomb. Octagons carry the connotation of stop signs. And stars, which signify excellence. Let's take a look at some very recognizable logos. Circles. Ovals. Squares. Rectangles. Triangles. Arrows. Polygons. And stars. Even if the logo symbol is more organic, it's often enclosed by a simple shape. While it's always good to make a connection between the shape and the brand values of the company, simplicity is not only acceptable, it is desirable. As well as offering the tools to easily create basic shapes, Illustrator also offers a number of ways to combine those shapes. Simple shapes can become more complex by adding, subtracting, intersecting, and overlapping them. Here I'm using the Pathfinder tools to do that. Add, subtract, intersect, and exclude, which uses the topmost object to punch a hole through the object beneath. Another tool that lets you add and subtract overlapping shapes is the Shape Builder. So here I have a series of overlapping circles. I'll select them, come and choose the Shape Builder tool. And first of all, to delete those parts that I don't want, hold down the Option or Alt key and just drag over those pieces to subtract them. Then, using a fill, I can come and drag over the segments that I want to combine. Many interesting effects can be achieved with the Live Paint tool, which lets you apply different color to each shape segment. Here I'm going to start out with a polygon, and then with my line tool, I will draw lines connecting one side with the other. Then I can swipe over that and come and choose my Live Paint bucket. Click on my selected item to make it into a Live Paint group, and then go and choose some colors to apply to the different segments. In the second example, I'm going to use the Polar Grid tool. click and hold down drag from the center point. I'm holding down my Alt key and my Shift key. Now I need to let go of those for just a moment. And if I press my down arrow, that will reduce the number of concentric rings, which in this case is what I want. And if I press my right arrow, that will increase the number of segments. And I'll hold the Alt and Shift key once again to constrain that. Now I can release, come and choose my live paint bucket, click to make a live paint group, and then I can apply alternating colors to each of these segments. Live paint can also be used to create an interlocking effect. I'll use my ellipse tool, and then I'm going to switch the fill and the stroke. I'll increase the weight of the stroke. Let's make that quite heavy. I'll now duplicate this by holding down the optional Alt key and the Shift key while I drag away from it. Apply a different color to the stroke of the second one. And now to create the impression of these two rings being interlocking, I first need to convert these strokes to outlines, to actually make them into fills. So with them both selected, I'll come to the Object menu and to Path and choose Outline Stroke. Then to my Live Paint bucket, and all I need to do is click to make it a Live Paint group, and then make sure I'm using one of those two colors to give the impression of the two rings interlocking. A fourth way in which you can create interesting shapes is to use transparency. And you can use that in combination with the rotate tool to create multiples of a shape, often radiating from a center point. So here I have my inverted triangle. I'll choose my rotate tool, hold down the optional Alt key, and click on the bottom anchor point. And then I'll choose an angle of rotation. Now to move the shapes to the right, I need a negative angle. I'm going to make that 10. Let's just have a look at the preview. And I'll go ahead and copy that. Now to repeat that transformation, I'll use the keyboard shortcut Command or Control D. And then I can swipe over that series of elements and come to my transparency panel and change the transparency blending mode from normal to, in this case, multiply.